This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I rejoice to be with y'all here this morning. My name is Tommy Prud'homme. I'm the pastor here at Salado United Methodist Church. I welcome all of you who are here with us in person this morning. Those of you who are gathered with us online for this time that God has given to us to do what we were created for, that is to worship God and to be in relationship with one another. Before we continue with our worship, a few announcements. First, I want to sort of give you the final count. You know, we back in February, we were involved in this Pathway to Giving initiative with the idea that we would sort of shift our thinking a little bit around the idea of giving and of generosity in general. I want to kind of let y'all know where we ended up on that, at least as of today. So we had 90 estimate of giving cards returned, which is great. We had 66 returned last year, so we did quite a bit better there. And we had $603,493 estimated in terms of the giving to the church this year, as opposed to $418 last year. So it was a substantial difference. And also, something that some of y'all may not realize is that during the course of the initiative, we had someone in this congregation step up and make a gift of over $33,000 to pay off the existing debt on this building. So, yeah. That is huge, huge, huge. And I'd love to tell you who it is, but I can't. Which is also pretty awesome. So I'm super excited. I'm excited, you know, about what this says about the ongoing financial viability of the church. But really, what I'm excited about is what this says about our growth, and our future growth in spiritual awareness and closeness to God within this congregation. I can't wait to see where we go from here. It's really, really, really an amazing thing. So thank you all so much. Also want to let you know, as you check through your announcements, you'll see as usual, there's lots of stuff going on. We are looking for a sound technician. Zach's going to be leaving us, which is, makes me very sad, but, you know, whenever a door closes, God opens another one. And so I'm sure, we'll get somebody good. If you know anybody who's interested in this, please, let them know and, or let us know. Also want to let you know that we're going to be doing another one of those informational sessions today about the upcoming general conference within the United Methodist Church, and also a little bit about our annual conference and just kind of an overview of how the United Methodist Church is organized. We're going to be doing, actually this Sunday, we're going to be doing one after this service and then also after the second service. We're going to be doing them over there in the chapel. So if you got time and that's something you're interested in learning a little more about, just head on over to the chapel after worship, and we'll be talking about it 30, 45 minutes. And that is about it. How about we go to God in prayer? Almighty, eternal, loving God, we thank you this morning for this creation that you've given to us to enjoy and to take care of on your behalf. We thank you this morning for our lives. We thank you that we are here this morning. We thank you for our families and this family of faith. Lord, you have blessed us so incredibly, so amply, Lord. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We've come here this morning to do just that, to thank you and to praise you for the blessings that you've given to us, for the love that you shower down on us, even when we don't realize you're doing it. Please help us in the days and weeks to come to open our eyes and our ears just a little bit more so that we can see all of those ways that you've blessed us. We raise these prayers up to you, seeking to praise you, seeking to thank you. And we ask this morning for your Spirit to help us in that. And we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. My name is Terry Livingston, and I am the Director of Music. And I'm so glad to see you all this morning and to welcome those who are joining us online. Would you please stand as we sing together, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Holy.
Please remain standing and join me in the creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Now be seated.
Good morning. My name is Paul Corder. I am the Director of Student Ministries here at Salado United Methodist Church, and we're so glad that you're here with us in worship today, both in person and online, and it's so good to be back. I was gone last week for winter camp, and we had a wonderful time, so thank you for all of you that prayed for us and supported that. And also a quick plug, we have mission trip coming up in June, so be in prayer for that too, that God brings youth to that, that God brings volunteers to that as we go and build ramps and serve food banks in Austin, Texas this coming June. So be sure and be in prayer for that, as well as those that you will find in the center of your bulletin. On the flip side of the announcements, you will find a list of people who are in need of prayer in our church community, in our families, and in Salado at large. And so we want to be sure and pray for those as we do our disciplines of prayer this week. So if you would please now join with me in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, as we celebrate the light of Jesus this morning, we recognize that many are not altogether convinced that the darkness is a thing of the past. Many people in this world of ours feel that the world is one of gloom. And the causes are many: bereavement, illness, money, worries about family, trouble at work, boredom, doubt, weariness, and futility. And in addition to these personal issues, there are the issues of our world, of war and poverty, disease, and all of the things that we face. And it doesn't help our hope when it seems that Christians don't always do as well as we should in helping solve these problems. So gracious and loving God, we rejoice that you are with us, that you know us and you love us, and that even though we've made a mess of things personally and collectively, that you remain faithful. We rejoice that your Son came not to a perfect world, but to a broken world, our world, to bring light to the darkness, to our darkness. We pray that you would show us Jesus this morning, the light of the world, the one who came to rid us of our sin, to give us a life of health and peace, of a peace that passes all understanding, not a temporary respite from trouble, but the strength to overcome it, and ultimately to succeed in life eternal. We have been set free this morning, so enable us to use our freedom to share in bringing the kingdom. And in the light of this, we must recognize that we have something to celebrate. We have something to shout about, to sing about, because even in our trouble and our pain, even in our loss, we know that Jesus is with us. So hear our prayers, Lord, spoken and unspoken, and answer them in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I'd like to invite you to stand as you are able as we continue to worship and pray, singing, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God."
His kingdom is
be seated.
Hello, my name's Raleigh Cray. I'm the Director of Outreach and Missions here for the church. And I just want to tell you about something that's coming up this next few weeks. In 2 weeks, we'll be having our wild game dinner. It's our biggest and our only fundraiser for the year, so we just want you to remember that. And next week, we would like for you to dress up in camo, kind of like this, but you can, you know, go cut some leaves and things if you don't have a camo or whatever. And
we will have a silent auction and a live auction and even a mini live auction for the kids. So, kids, where are you? Make sure you get cash from your parents, like $1 bills, because we're going to have some really cute prizes for y'all to bid against each other.
Speaking of the silent auction, we're going to have it on our cell phone. So this is the first time you'll be able to do that, and you can see what items we will have on the silent auction, and you'll be able to bid on them about a week early.
This is a community-wide event. We just want to remind everybody, so y'all tell everybody you know, because we want them over there with us. And of course, we always end our event with a live auction. And we've got things out there like trips and prizes and hunts and things you just don't want to miss out on.
And the food is the most amazing part of the wild auction here, of wild game dinner. But then again, if you don't be afraid, if you don't want to eat any wild deer or whatever, we do have hot dogs, hamburgers, we'll even have wild cow. That's brisket.
So y'all remember to wear your camo next Sunday so that we can advertise to the whole community and to each other, because on March the 17th is our big day. And out in the foyer are information, more information and signups. Thank you all.
Thank y'all.
So yet another opportunity for us to show our generosity. And if you haven't been to the wild game dinner, you just got to go. It is something. Last year was my first year to do it, and I was just like blown away. It's an amazing, amazing event. So if the ushers would please come forward, let us go to God now in prayer. Eternal, loving, and almighty God, we once again come before you in thanksgiving and praise for the blessings that you've given to us. We thank you especially this morning for the blessing of your Son, Jesus, for the salvation that has been made available to us through him, for the eternal life that we are enabled to live in your presence through him. We ask that you accept these gifts that we offer to you now as expressions of our thanksgiving and of our praise, and we ask that you help them to enable us as we seek to build your kingdom here on earth, just as it is in heaven. And we ask this in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sing a song in the shadow. Good morning. My name is Terry Crane. I'll be reading to you from John, first chapter, verses 1 through 5 and 10 through 13. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So this is, I believe, the third Sunday of Lent, which is the season where we anticipate the coming, well, actually not the coming of Jesus, the coming back of Jesus through his resurrection on Easter morning. And the celebration that we will have then. Now, as I mentioned last week, the creed that we are studying during this season of Lent, the Apostles' Creed, the summation, the statement of our faith as Christians, it's organized in three, basically three parts: the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, the Trinity, the Holy Trinity. And so last week we talked about God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so this Sunday we're going to talk about Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. Now, if you were paying attention when we professed that creed just a few minutes ago, you'll notice that Jesus occupies a lot of that creed, right? 10 of the 18 lines in that creed are dedicated to Jesus. The majority of that creed is about Jesus. Why do you think that is? Right? I mean, and I guess one reason for that is that as far as the Father, God the Father is concerned, that wasn't really very controversial among the early Christians. The Christians are spiritually descended from the Jews, and the Jews had had a couple of millennia at least to work out who the eternal Almighty Father is. And then as to the Holy Spirit, you know, why there's not more about the Holy Spirit, well, I mean, there's not a whole lot to say. The Holy Spirit is mysterious. Like Jesus says, it's like the wind going here and there. There's just not much to say. So there you got. You got Jesus sort of right there in the middle, right between the Father, right between the Son, kind of the middle, the whole meat of the middle of that creed. Really kind of the center on which, around which the creed is based. Which is really kind of the way it should be, don't you think? I mean, one of the images that I just love, and if you're in our Wednesday night Bible study, you'll probably recognize this, is the idea of a garden, right? There's if you go back to the very beginning of the Bible, the very beginning of the book of Genesis, there's this garden, the Garden of Eden, right? Where God put Adam and Eve to live. And then if you go to the very other end of the Bible, to the very end of the story, the end of the book of Revelation, you got another garden. You've got this garden that came into existence when the New Jerusalem descended from heaven to earth. There's this river of life running through the middle of it, and you got the tree of life planted on its banks. You got a garden at the beginning, you got a garden at the end, and then right there in the middle, right between those two gardens is another garden. It's the garden in which Jesus was buried. It's the garden in which Jesus was resurrected. It's the garden in which the sin and disobedience of Adam and Eve is undone. It's the garden which makes possible that garden at the very end, where the entire universe, all of creation, is brought to fulfillment. See, just as Jesus is the center, the pivot of the creed that we recite, he's also the pivot, the center of God's redemptive history, of God's story, of the redeeming of us and of all creation. So who is this Jesus who's the center of it all? And well, I mean, we can start with the non-controversial stuff. Jesus existed. Used to be people would kind of argue against that, but really, you can't argue seriously against that. We got too much evidence. Jesus was a good guy. He was a really good guy. I think pretty much everybody would agree with that. In fact, he was a really, really good moral teacher. Very good moral teacher. Even the atheists would agree with that. But we as Christians, of course, we believe that he's much more than that. And so we recite this creed and we say, I believe in Jesus Christ. He is the Christ. Now, Christ comes from the Greek word Christos, which means simply anointed. And Christos is a Greek translation of the Hebrew word Messiah, which also means anointed, which in the context of old Israel means the king, right? Because that's what you did back then. Is like whenever someone was proclaimed to be the king, whenever they were coronated or whatever you call it, they were anointed with oil. And that symbolized that they were chosen by God to lead God's people. Now, eventually,
the kings in Israel kind of went away. That the whole monarchy sort of petered out. But even then, the prophets of the Jewish people said, you know, there's going to come a day where there is the ultimate Messiah, the ultimate king, the ultimate anointed one, and he is going to restore the fortunes of God's people. He is going to redeem God's people, bring them back to where they belong. And when we proclaim this creed, we say, Jesus is that Christ. Jesus is that Messiah. He's that anointed one. He is the king. But what does it mean for Jesus to be a king? Well, a lot of people in Jesus' day, including probably every one of his disciples, and even some people today, believe that that means he's a political leader. He was going to be a revolutionary, like in the sense of getting an army together and overthrowing the Roman Empire, or at least kicking the Roman Empire out of Palestine. But Jesus, over and over again, when you read the Gospels, over and over again, he rejects this understanding of what it meant to be a king. In fact, at the very end of his life, right before he was executed, he's being interrogated by Pontius Pilate. And Pilate asks him, he's trying to get an answer out of Jesus, and finally, just in exasperation, he says, "Are you a king?" And Jesus basically says to him, "Yeah, I'm a king. But my kingdom is not of this world." And I always wish Pontius Pilate would have asked the next question, right? Which is, well, then what kind of kingdom is it? What kind of king are you? And that's what the scripture that we just read is about. It's about what kind of king Jesus is, because he's not just a king, he's also God's only son. I mean, that's what that means. You know, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, John, the author of that gospel, later identifies Jesus as that Word. Jesus is that Word that was with God, that was God in the very beginning, the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us. The second person of the Holy Trinity. Jesus is a king. He is the Christ. But his kingdom is not of this world. It is of every world. It is of the spiritual realm, of the physical realm, of all creation. I mean, his kingdom is so far beyond any earthly kingdom or political power. It's as far above all of that stuff as the eternal, almighty God is above us. All of which is really good, but it's still just kind of a little bit abstract, I think, right? Yeah, okay, we've got this Jesus. He is a king and he is God's only son, but what does that mean for me? What difference does that make in my life? And that's where we get to the last part of that first line, right? I believe in Jesus the Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. Our Lord. What does it mean for Jesus to be our Lord? We talked about this a little bit a couple of weeks ago. What does it mean for Jesus to be our Lord? Back in Jesus' day, Caesar claimed to be Lord. He was actually on the money. Caesar is Lord. And what that meant for the people in Rome and in that empire was that they owed their ultimate loyalty and their ultimate allegiance to Caesar and to the empire that he represented. They're saying, you know, I'm trusting Caesar to look after me. I'm trusting Caesar to have, at least in the big picture, my best interests at heart. And in response, I'm going to obey. I'm going to give him my loyalty and my allegiance. And when we declare, as we do in that creed, Jesus as our Lord, we are saying much the same thing. We're saying, I trust Jesus. I give Jesus my ultimate loyalty and allegiance. I believe that Jesus knows what is best for me. I believe that Jesus wants what is best for me, that Jesus loves me and is going to do what is best for me. I promise to follow him. I promise to obey him. But we take it a step beyond what those Romans did, right? Because while they, you know, while they professed to believe that Caesar was Lord, while they professed to obey Caesar, they didn't necessarily have to like it. Right? I mean, because Caesar did promise peace, right? The Pax Romana. He promised them peace. He promised that he would take care of them, but at the expense of a brutal and oppressive military regime. But when we declare Jesus as our Lord, when we declare our allegiance and our loyalty to Jesus, we're not doing it out of fear. We're not doing it under the threat of violence. We remember that his kingdom is not of this world. Like we talked about last week, his Father God loved us all into existence. When we declare our loyalty and our allegiance to Jesus, we're doing it out of love, not fear. But here's the thing. That declaration of loyalty, that declaration of allegiance to Jesus, it doesn't come without a cost. Back in Jesus' day, it could get you in big trouble. It could even get you killed. Right? Because if you said Jesus is Lord, what does that mean? Who isn't Lord then? Caesar. If you say Jesus is Lord, Caesar's not Lord. And like I said, that could get you in trouble. That could get you killed. And it got a lot of people killed. And it's kind of like that today. Now, certainly in the United States, if you declare Jesus as your Lord, you're unlikely to get into a lot of trouble. It might even get you elected to public office. But actually living the way Jesus lived, actually living the way he told us to live, actually doing the things that he did and doing the things that he said, loving your enemies, I mean, that's crazy. Doing that kind of stuff, living your life as if Jesus is really Lord in a culture where power and greed and safety and security are actually Lord. It's just as countercultural as it was then. And it could get you in trouble. Jesus was a good man. He was the best moral teacher in the history of human civilization. But he was way, way more than that. He's a king. He's the king of everything. And he is God's only son. He is the second person of the Holy Trinity. He is divine. And he stepped out of eternity into our world to live among us, to show us what it looks like to live the way we were created to live in God's love, to explain to us about how to do that, to die. Remember what we just read, the creator of everything, to die a painful death as a criminal so that we could live the kind of life that he lived, so that we could live in that love that God created us to live in, and then to be resurrected in that garden so that we could enjoy that new, bountiful, eternal life for eternity. That's what we're saying when we say, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. And if we really believe that, if we really believe that's who he is and that's what happened, how can we do anything but have him as our Lord? How can we do anything but follow him? How can we do anything but trust him? How can we do anything but declare to ourselves, to the world around us, he is my King. He is my Lord. Now we've got an opportunity right now to celebrate Jesus' Lordship. That's one of the things that we do when we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. We celebrate who Jesus is, celebrate what he has done for us. We remember it. And through the bread and the juice, we sort of imbibe it. We take it into us. We reaffirm over and over and over again every time we participate in this sacrament who we are and whose we are. On the evening in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took some bread. It was the bread that they had at the Passover feast, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he passed it around to his disciples, and he said to them, "This is my body." Now, they didn't realize at the time that this was the second person of the Holy Trinity talking to them. "This is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." At the end of the dinner, he took a cup of wine and he blessed it and he passed it around to his disciples and he said to them, "This is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this, and as often as you do so in remembrance of me." Would you join me now in prayer? Loving and almighty God, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon all of us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and juice, that they may be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, so that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed through his blood. Lord, we ask with your Holy Church, through your Son, Jesus Christ, and in the Holy Spirit, we may be one flesh, one family, one church. We ask all of this in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so could those who are going to help come on down? You help him.
Thank you.
So as I hopefully say every time we do this, I want to make sure that y'all understand that this is not the United Methodist Church's table. It's not this church's table. It's Christ's table. And he invites to it all who repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another and declare Jesus Christ as their Lord. We have a gluten-free option here for anybody who would like that. Christ has set the table for his beloved. Let us now eat.
Thank you.
Thanks be to God. All right, so as we sing this last hymn, I want to invite anybody who's with us this morning who would like to join with us in mission and ministry as part of this family of faith to come on up. We would love to welcome you home.
Would you stand as you're able as we sing together?
Y'all can be seated for just a minute. I have got something really exciting that I get to do right now. I get to introduce y'all, if you hadn't already met them, to Gerald and Karen Stewart, who moved here not too long ago from the Houston area, and they want to join with us as part of this family of faith. And so I just have several questions for y'all, but you only have to answer once. Do you promise to support this congregation, this family of faith, with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. And so I'm going to ask you all the same questions since we're asking them to join into ministry with us. Do you support, promise to continue supporting this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? All right. So they're here. They're with us now. And we're not going to let them go. And so if y'all could wait at the back with me so that anybody who wants to meet you can, how about we go and do that right now? We can get set up. Hear this good word, the benediction today, and the benediction is Jesus. Jesus, 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 the center of our world, the center of our lives, the center of creation, Jesus. May Jesus be so much a part of who you are that everyone who meets you says, I want to get me some of that Jesus. May the love of God, the peace of Jesus Christ, and the joy and communion of the Holy Spirit be yours today and tomorrow and forevermore. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.
Would you stand as we sing God be with you till we meet again? Don't forget to meet the Stewarts.